Yeah. All right. Well, thanks, Ryan. And as we get started, I have asked Ryan to act a little bit as a moderator. Once I kind of get through an intro, we're going to go on the move so that we can check out some of the animals and exhibits. So I'm going to switch over to my phone to give us a little bit more flexibility. And I encourage you, as we're moving through the different exhibits and getting introduced to some of the different animals, to ask questions in the chat. And then Ryan will kind of field them and he'll unmute and ask those questions so that we can get those questions answered. Or we can defer to Dick Anderson, who is one of our longest standing volunteers at the aquarium, who's joining us tonight. He's been around longer than I have here at the aquarium. So just a shout out to some of our great community here at the aquarium. As Ryan mentioned, I'm the Director of Learning and Engagement here at Great Lakes Aquarium. I just celebrated my 10-year aquariversary in December, so I've been here for 10 years. And today we're going to take a walk around the St. Louis River exhibit, which is behind me here. Now, if you don't live in the Twin Ports or haven't visited Duluth, you might not be familiar with the St. Louis River. I'm looking out over the St. Louis River, but the glare and the darkness makes it a little difficult to see. The St. Louis River is the largest river that empties into Lake Superior. So essentially, the St. Louis River is the headwaters of all of the rest of the Great Lakes. Water flows from the St. Louis River into Lake Superior and then empties down throughout the rest of the Laurentian Great Lakes here in the Midwest. So it's the longest river emptying into the lake. It's about 190 miles. And it's a rich landscape that often gets overlooked as people visiting the Twin Ports here in Duluth and Superior often find their way coming for the Big Lake, for Lake Superior. But the St. Louis River is a very important part of that St. or the Lake Superior ecosystem. So as we walk through each of the exhibits that we're going to be visiting today, it has been modeled to support an animal that lives in the St. Louis River, but it's important to remember that the habitats are designed for animal care purposes. So we will see ducks and turtles in the same exhibit, but none of these animals exist alone. So they're all connected. The ecosystem is not as separate as we're going to see it here today. Each of those animals, each of the people, each of the plants all work together to make this really rich landscape along the St. Louis River. And the St. Louis River is quite literally a sum of all of those parts. Now, one of the things that I want you to think about, because the St. Louis River is flowing into Lake Superior, that water stays in Lake Superior for a very long time. If we think about the last time there was a global pandemic, a drop of water entering Lake Superior at that time is likely still in Lake Superior. The retention time in Lake Superior is 191 years. So whatever happens along the St. Louis River is very important to the health and continued the ecosystem of Lake Superior, because that water goes in and it takes a long time before that water either leaves through evaporation or out through the river. So we're going to take a look at some of those animals today. And I'm going to take just a moment here to switch over so that I can go on the move. And we're going to start by trying to visit with the skunks. So we're going to start at the skunks and we're going to work our way around to some reptiles and then to some fish. So we're going to go on a little tour. If you give me just a moment, I'm going to pause my video so we don't get any feedback and we're going to go on the move.
All right. Ryan, can you let me know? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
All right, we're on the move. So first stop here I'm going to give you, I'll give you an overview of what this exhibit gallery looks like. And then our first stop will be to go and visit the skunks. And I think we're going to have to look at them inside their den because they have not come out yet. So this is on the second floor of our exhibit gallery. And we have our St. Louis River exhibit. This is one of the long exhibits. We'll stop here in a little bit to visit some of the ducks and turtles. And then I was sitting over there by the window, which overlooks the St. Louis River estuary. We'll kind of talk about that. And then over on the other side, we've got another really big turtle, a snapping turtle named Crush, and some fish over here. And eventually we're gonna end up with one of my favorite St. Louis River stories. We're gonna talk about sturgeon. So we'll head downstairs to visit our largest sturgeon named Helga. So I'm gonna go inside the skunk habitat here and see if we can find what they're up to. So we have two skunks living here at Great Lakes Aquarium, and their skunks are pretty ubiquitous across Minnesota. Now inside, if you've ever wondered what it's like to be inside an exhibit, here we go. And you get fun stuff to play with, some good enrichment. You might get an orca whale that has similar markings. And this is the skunk's log. So we're gonna peek in here. And they're there. Oh, they're gonna come out. So I imagine the first thing you might think of when you hear the word skunk is probably their smell. Ooh, so we have two skunks. This one's, yeah. Don't worry, Ryan, their scent glands have been removed. So this one here with a large white marking, this one is Snoops, and Snacks just headed down, ooh, into the edge of their tunnel. We'll see if they come out here. But the truth of the matter is that skunks actually don't really have that bad of a smell. It's our nose, the chemistry of our noses that amplifies the smell. Oh, there they are, they're looking at me. So our noses do a really good job of amplifying the smell of sulfur. We'll see. They're maybe backing up. We'll see if they come out. Oh, we're gonna turn around, here we go. So our noses do a really good job of amplifying the smell of sulfur or thiols. And it's really helpful for our survival. So if you've ever gone to your refrigerator, opened up the refrigerator, thought, I wonder if this milk or these leftovers are still good. You open it up and the first thing you do is smell it. And if it's starting to go bad, our nose amplifies that smell and then it protects us from eating something that could potentially make us sick. So amplifying skunk smell is good for our survival, but not so good if you've ever had a pet that has encountered a skunk. And one of the reasons why that's so bad is because it's very difficult to remove skunk smell. It's very sticky. Ooh, here we go. Now skunks are actually pretty good neighbors as long as you don't have an animal that wants to be friends with them. Oh, they may have gone all the way back up there. We'll check in on them in a moment here. Because they tend to help keep populations of unwanted pests under pretty good control. They have really long claws for digging. And here at the aquarium, they go outside. This week, they haven't been outside so much. They do their exercise at different parts of the aquarium. Oh, moving from one den to another, that was quick. But they spend 30 minutes either on a walk around the building or outside when it's not below zero. And they use those sharp claws to dig up different things. They eat a lot of grubs, ant eggs. They eat dandelions. They also will eat small rodents like mice, things that we don't want marching into our house. So they are one of the animals that helps control the population of kind of what we would consider to be nuisance or pests. The unfortunate thing is they also, this nice little log that we're visiting is kind of akin to maybe your front porch. So they like to find those places to kind of hang out and nest. And skunks usually will give a warning before they decide to spray. So they'll stamp their feet, they might lift up their tail and posture. And then if all else fails, they're gonna use their secret weapon, which is that spray. And it can spray 10 to 15 feet. So you don't even have to be really that close to them to get that smell. And as I mentioned, it's very sticky. So if you've ever had an animal that's been sprayed by a skunk, you know that it may have taken a long time to get that scent out. But our modern domesticated animals like dogs, if they see a skunk turning and lifting its tail, they take that as an invitation to come over and say hello, because that's how they greet one another, the dogs, and then they get a face full of skunk spray. So that's not so great. All right, we're gonna take one more peek. I think Snoops went back into the other den. We'll say goodnight to Snacks here. And good night, Snacks. I thought they might be a little more active. Skunks in the wild are typically nocturnal. So these two are a little snoozy tonight, but we got a chance to visit with them. Make sure no one's around, and we're going back out. We have lots of sets of double doors here to make sure that everybody, all the animals stay where they're supposed to. All right. Any questions about skunks as we're moving on to our next spot? Oh, you might be able to hear the ducks. I did tell Ryan earlier that the ducks were a little sassy this evening, so they're excited to see you.
Oh yes, they've got plenty to tell us.
So one of the really, I'm gonna see if I can get in between the mesh here, there.
So we've got
our group of mallards. Oh, do skunks make sounds? Oh.
Yeah, and Marie wants to know how you walk them outdoors.
Ooh, great question, Marie. We actually have a set, they are harness trained. So each of them have their own colored harness that is set to their particular size. Snoops has much fluffier fur than Snacks, so they have to be tightened in a different way. So they each have their own separate harness on their own separate hook. And it kind of goes underneath their shoulders, kind of like either a dog harness, or I think they're actually, it might be ferret harnesses that we actually use. So we use a leash because then we can keep track of them. But when we're walking them, it's our responsibility to allow the skunks to do their own thing. So we might go outside together. Usually two people are walking them, but we oftentimes end up on different sides of the property because the skunks choose to do different things. So one might spend a lot of time digging on a particular hillside, eating roots from a dandelion, and the other one may be more interested in roaming along the edge of the building and digging for grubs over there. So that's how we walk them. And I would assume they make sounds. I don't know if I've ever heard them make sounds, but I assume if they made a sound, it might be similar to like a cat barking, like a vocalization, but I don't think I have never heard them make a sound. So they might. I'll have to look that up. So one of the things that I personally really love about the St. Louis River, and one of the things that I spend the most time doing along the St. Louis River, is birding. And so if anyone else either lives with a bird nerd, like the one who might be watching from my house, or you like to watch birds on your own, the St. Louis River is a really rich landscape for finding birds. And we get lots of different birds that migrate through the area, and then we have lots of different resident birds. And so from the birding on the river is the best. So from along the shore, where we see in some of the kind of transition habitat, we can see all sorts of different warblers and other birds as they move through migrating. They don't migrate over the big lakes. So we see a lot of those birds skirt around the edge to a lot of the waterfowl. And then we have some rare birds as well. We've got some different populations of plovers. So here we go. Here at the aquarium, we have two different types of ducks currently. We've got our mallards and we have two wood ducks. And all of the ducks that live here at the aquarium were rehabbed. So for avian rehab, we have gotten them from different, here's the nice, let's see if we can get it on the male wood duck there. So handsome. So the goal of rehab, animal rehab, is to get that animal back into health and back out into the wild. if at all possible. And sometimes due to the injuries, the extent of the injuries, that might not be possible. And so if those animals have gone through whatever the rehabs kind of requirements are, if their quality of life would be such that they could live in human care and be taken care of, then they might look for placements at zoos or aquariums like these ducks we have here. So at least one of the, I think one of the mallards is missing an eye. I can't remember which one it is. Some of them have wing injuries. Some of them, one of them was infected with an unknown toxin. And then probably the one that looks the strangest and we get the most guest questions on is the female wood duck. And you can see her over there. And it looks like her beak is resting on, I'm gonna try and get it focused in here. Her beak is resting on the turf there near the turtle. And she was born with a condition, a bacterial infection called torticollis, also called wry neck. And what that means is that it can happen in rabbits. I think it can even happen in humans, but it doesn't allow her to pick up her neck and straighten it out. And other than her neck just looking a little strange, she might need to receive a little extra care, veterinary care throughout her life, but otherwise she's doing really well. In fact, that duck who we call Nick, she lays an egg almost every single day. So just like you might find in a chicken, if you have chickens, or she lays almost every day. They're not fertilized. We've never seen any sort of breeding behavior between her and the male wood duck, but she does lay an egg every day. And that's a good sign. That means that she is getting the nutrients she needs and she's doing pretty well. So every once in a while, we'll get a call that there's an egg on the bottom of the exhibit and we know it's not fertilized, but we do come and scoop those out. So she's got eggs. Now, some of the other residents in this particular habitat also think, because I'm here and because I'm wearing a uniform, that they might be getting something to eat. We have quite a few turtles here. And again, especially in some of those oxbows and turns where the water gets a little slower, on parts of the St. Louis River and sandy shores is great turtle habitat because that allows them the space to come on and lay their eggs. So here in the corner, we have three painted turtles. And then here comes, we'll have to watch out. The Blanding's turtle has been pestering some of the other turtles because it's getting to be springtime. And I don't know if she's looking for a mate or what, but she's been pestering the other turtles. It looks like she's giving them some space. But we have our painted turtles here and they're identified by those bright markings along their underside. And I think this might be the fall. I think we have a false map turtle in here. And then we also have a red-eared slider. I think she was up on the land. So the map turtle is not found in the St. Louis River, but it was one of the turtles that, this is the exhibit that it best fits in. You will find red-eared sliders. Blanding's turtles are threatened here in Minnesota. One thing that happens to turtles because they are ground nesters, any habitat disturbances, or humans often like to recreate in the same places that are really great for turtles to laying their eggs. And turtles are a very long-lived group of animals. So Blanding's turtles they don't mature until they're, you know, maybe over 10 years old. And that means that it takes them a long time to reach breeding age. And if they're nesting in a spot that's easily disturbed, either by a dog or by humans, that increases, she's gonna start pestering those turtles there. That increases the chances for the nests to be kind of raided or disturbed. So there's the red-eared slider up there. And red-eared sliders are not native, but we can find red-eared sliders in most waterways throughout the Midwest. And they are the story of released pets. So red-eared sliders are very popular for pets at home. And then once you realize that turtles live for a really long time, sometimes people will release them into the nearest waterway. And that's not so great because then that disrupts the balance between the native species. It competes for food and space. And so when you find red-eared sliders throughout Minnesota, they weren't there previously. All those red-eared sliders came from released pets. So while we're talking about turtles, we're gonna visit one of my favorite turtles. And I think my daughter might be watching, and she also, this is one of her favorite animals here at the aquarium. And this is Crush. Crush is a snapping turtle. He weighs about 50 pounds. And our best estimate is that he's probably between 50 and 70 years old. And he came to us, we'll see if he moves a little bit. He came to us from Reptile Land, an organization in Pennsylvania, and they acquired him from a conservation officer. And the provenance gets a little murky. I'm not sure if it was they were surrendered or somebody was keeping him illegally, and that's how he ended up in the care of the conservation officer. But he's been here, I think, close to almost six years, maybe. And he is just such a cool turtle. He eats just twice a week because snapping turtles, one of the things that we can tell, oh, he's gonna reach up to take a breath, and you can really see how long that neck is. One of the things you can notice by comparing different types of turtle is you can learn a lot about what their habitat is like by looking at their body. And that's true of most animals. So for the snapping turtle, we see that the plastron, the underside of their shell, so the turtle shell has two pieces. The carapace is the top or the cap, and then the underside is the plastron. And you can even see from looking at this angle at Crush that there's a lot of exposed flesh and skin. And where the turtles we were just looking at, for example, the Blanding's turtle can pull their legs, tail, and head, and even they have a little hinge so they can almost completely seal their shell, which means if they're on land, they can protect themselves from would-be predators. Here, or the snapping turtle, you can see as he's standing up here, you can see that if this snapping turtle was exposed on land, they just really wouldn't be able to protect themselves in that same way. Because even if they pulled their legs, their really long neck and tail in, they have so much exposed flesh that they would be very vulnerable. So we know that snapping turtles are primarily aquatic turtles because that is where they are the safest. They can't move very fast on land, and they often get a bad rap. Here we can see them breathing here. They often get a bad rap because the name snapping, because the best defense is a good offense. So when they're on land, they seem a lot more aggressive, and that is for a reason, because they need to be aggressive in order to protect themselves. So here's Crush. He does have land on his exhibit, and I have seen him on land the entire time he's been here at the aquarium. I have seen him once, and we don't see evidence of him being on land. So he's a big turtle, so if he moved around on land, we would see that scraping, and we don't see it. So that is true to his aquatic nature, but he is such a cool turtle. One of my favorite things about Crush, and pre-COVID times, we would do a feeding program, and Crush is one of my favorite programs to do because, number one, he's an awesome turtle, and it's super cool to watch him eat. He eats a variety of food, from mice to fish to chunks of quail, and he also gets, mostly in the summertime. In the winter, his diet has dropped a little bit because he's a little less active, but he will sometimes get different fruits and vegetables for enrichment. And that is pretty entertaining. My favorite enrichment was once they gave him a personal size watermelon, and he chased it around his exhibit for such a long time. And they finally broke it open for him so that he could chomp on the fruit. But they wouldn't be normally looking for fruit in their habitat. They're definitely meat eaters. But one of the things that we get to see here at the aquarium is all the different ways that that enrichment is offered to the animals to make sure that not only their habitat where they live is fulfilling all their needs, but that they get some different kinds of activities to keep their body busy as well. All right, we're gonna start moving on to fish. Oh, the great question, was that from Deanna? The best way to pick up a snapping turtle is to not pick it up necessarily, but they have a really, really long neck. And what I always recommend, especially because when you look at crush here, we'll go back here. That's a really good question because we're getting to be, well, eventually in a few months, it will be springtime and we're going to start seeing animals cross the road, or turtles cross the road. And it's not a joke. Why did the turtle cross the road? They cross the road because they're going to lay their eggs. Because as I mentioned, they don't really go on land. So the only time you really see them moving up onto land is when they're going up to lay their eggs, and especially gravel roadsides. Again, it's where the humans are, but it's also where their preferred nesting habitat is. So especially a big boy like Crush, he can reach, his neck is so long that even if you tried to pick them up by the back of his shell, number one, he's like 50 pounds. And number two, his neck can swing around. So my go-to is if you can use that snow shovel, if you live in the Midwest, that you keep in your car and try and shoo, or if it's a smaller snapping turtle, you could try and use it to lift it in the direction that it's going. Because you don't, even if the water's on the other side of the road, move it in the direction it's going. It's got a plan. And you never want to try and get it to clamp down and bite on something, because inside their shell, their vertebrae are attached to the inside of the shell. They keep that shell their whole life. They don't remove it. And so their neck is connected, and those vertebrae are connected all along to the shell. So if you had them try and snap onto a stick or pull them in that way, you could really injure the turtle. There we go. So we're moving on from turtles. Any other turtle questions? I do love turtles.
No, nothing in the chat. That's a really, really good advice. Snow shovel. It's always handy in a Minnesotan's car.
Yes. Yes. All right. So we're moving on to some fish, and we'll get a little sneak peek of some sturgeon. We've got some little sturgeon up here in this exhibit, but we'll eventually move downstairs. And Ryan, can you be, let's see. Oh, no, I got my time. We're good. We're doing great on time. I can keep talking about animals for longer. So we're gonna visit some fish, and the St. Louis River is a really rich fishery, and it's got a little bit of a complicated history in the more recent history, because some of the human actions over the last 100 years have impacted where the spawning habitat for different species of fish are, and the area, the young hatcheries where the fish are safe to grow up. And so some of those industries, as logging moved west across the United States, Minnesota had really big, beautiful lumber, and that lumber in our region was moved down into the St. Louis River and down to sawmills along the St. Louis River, and then out shipped out through Lake Superior. So as the demand for lumber grew, the St. Louis River became a waterway, and that industry was the sawmills up along the St. Louis River. And one of the things that there, I think it's, and Ryan or anyone else from over there can correct me, I think one of the projects they were starting either last summer or this summer, or potentially one of the current projects, was dredging out some of the feet thick of debris from the logging. Does that sound familiar?
Yeah, that sounds familiar. I might defer to Deanna for details, but.
Yeah, Radio Tower Bay, they pulled something like, I forget, tons and tons of
debris
out of there, but also Kingsbury Bay, that is near the Wabash-Ishikana, the Western Waterfront Trail, that they pulled that out last summer, along with a lot of invasive cattails. So really, really great back bays that have still water for good places for fish that are gonna have better bottom habitat for them now.
Yeah. And Deanna, I can't remember. I know I read part of the management plan that talked about how deep some of that wood debris was. So this is from the sawmills that were on the river. And as they were cutting the boards and milling, then the kind of just the little bits and pieces fell off, and then they would be in the river. So it was like feet thick,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Like up to 8 feet.
Yeah, I was gonna say close to 10 feet thick. And so if you think about the kind of habitat that fish really need, you know, the the in the back bays, kind of the cover and the safe places for them to be. If the bottom is just all wood, there's not that nice.
There's no plants. There's not
no plants. Bugs. No cover. There's no food, no cover. So all the things you need for the habitat, the food, water, shelter, and space is not present. And so one of the things that I love about this St. Louis River and about our community is that there are so many success stories and so many folks who are devoted to kind of restoring those things from the St. Louis River and that are happening now. So, and that we can see those bits. And when we start talking about sturgeon recovery, we can talk more about some of those, the successes and the really exciting things that we are seeing here in the river. So speaking of sturgeon, we'll try and get the glare. We'll get up close. We've got some, thank you, Deanna and Ryan, for the aside. So we've got a couple of sturgeon in here. These are younger sturgeon. You know, I'm not exactly sure how old they are. I would have to guess, they might be in the range of maybe 12-ish. And at least one of these sturgeon was in our grayling habitat, which was one of our coldest habitats. And until it moved into the St. Louis River habitat, its growth rate was much, much slower. So their growth rate is definitely affected by the water habitat or by the water temperature. So this one, this habitat's a little bit warmer. Over here we have, hiding in the corner, we've got some walleye, and there is are some good walleye populations along the St. Louis River. You can see kind of looming above me here some of the cover. we've got some artificial plants because the when you put real plants in a aquatic habitat, the fish tend to destroy them. So we've got some artificial plants, but we do have some real logs that are floating, and then you'll see that the animals will shift their position to hide under the cover. And we've got another walleye back there. And I'm gonna try and move along slowly without making anyone too motion sick. And we're gonna stop by some of the big predators in the St. Louis River. So we've got, I think there are two muskie and one northern pike in this exhibit. So that's one of the, or some of the fish that really draw anglers to the river are these big kind of game species. This is a muskie. And one of the things that I like to look for when I'm working on identifying the difference between pike and muskie, they can look very similar. And sometimes their color patterns present very differently. And sometimes they look kind of similar, but I like to think of how the patterns across their bodies look. Muskies have more, it looks kind of like somebody when they were making the pattern on the side of their body, they dipped their fingers in paint and dragged their fingers vertically. And then when we'll look for the pike here, it looks like the pike, like the paint was dipped and pulled horizontally. So when you kind of look at those color patterns, this muskie has a little bit stronger patterning, I think. So you can see that it has more of that vertical pattern. Ooh. There we go. Oh, we've got a catfish sneaking up. There are some catfish here. Another way that you can tell a muskie from a pike is there are some pores underneath their chin. And muskies have, I think, 6 to 9 pores, whereas northern pike have fewer. They have 4 or 5 underneath. So we're gonna see if we can get a good view of the... the muskie is definitely keeping one eye on me to see if I have anything to feed it. The keeper for this exhibit says that when she's cleaning, that so we use a variety of different tools. Obviously, she's not going to reach into this exhibit because she doesn't want to meet the sharp end of the muskies in northern. So she's got some tools with her scrub brushes on a long pole. And when she cleans this exhibit in the morning, they just track her and follow her all along the exhibit. And then when she feeds them, and she's moving along, they continue to follow her even though she's dropped the food in. So she has to stand in front of them, drop the food, and then they'll hit it really quick and move on. Otherwise, they just follow her. All right, so here's our northern. I'm gonna see if I can position this in a way that we can, we get a reflection. It looks like two northern. So again, you see it's got more of kind of that, the darker green color, and it looks more of the horizontal drag across the body. And then we've got some catfish. There's one here, and I know there was another one kind of hiding up undercover. And catfish, they're cool cats. They're one of my favorite fish to talk about in terms of their senses, because catfish often live in, oh, it's gonna come up in front of us. Catfish often live in murky water, and in order to, oh, here we go. Let's see. In order to find food, no pictures, please. There we go. In order to find food in murky water, you have to rely on senses other than your sense of sight. And catfish have the sense of taste to spare. So when we talk about taste buds, fish can have taste buds in their mouth. They can have taste buds kind of right around, they can have taste buds right around the outside of their mouth. But catfish, I like to think of as one giant tongue swimming through the water, because they have external taste buds. They have taste buds all along the side of their body. And that's useful for finding food, because they can sense that food, they can taste in the water to locate their prey. And so they have barbels or whiskers that hang down in front of them. And we'll talk about that with sturgeon as well. So they have those whiskers that hang down that are very sensitive, that are sensory organs, but they also have external taste buds all down the side of their body. Pretty cool. I certainly would not want to taste the water I was swimming in, but I guess if you have to find food, it works.
That's really, really wild to think about.
Yeah. Yeah. Giant tongue swimming around. So I think we've got a little bit more time left. So my plan is to head downstairs and we're going to visit the big sturgeon, and we're going to talk about sturgeon and Lake Superior in the St. Louis River, because that's one of my favorite stories, and sturgeon are super cool. Yeah. So we'll stop and say hi to our moose friend here.
Moose is
practicing proper social distancing. It's 6 feet from its friend. Although I have not made the caribou mask yet. So maybe this weekend we'll get the caribou masked up.
I'm going to travel.
And I am the only person in the building right now. I think our night operator will be coming in soon, which is why I've got my mask, but I don't have it on because we're closed and I may be the only person here. So we're going to come down the stairs. We'll see if we can get a little night shot here of the St. Louis River. So this, we are right at the edge. This is part of the working harbor here. So we see a lot of ships coming in. I like to say that Lake Superior, the ships that come into Lake Superior have touched all the oceans of the world. So that's our really big connection to the other waterways of the world. Is we see ships coming from all over the world here to our ports in Duluth and Superior. And that brings us all the good and bad things that come with being connected to the waters of the world. All right, we're moving into major sturgeon territory here. I am in a little bubble here in our largest exhibit. This is 26 feet deep, and here is one of our lake sturgeon. So this habitat is home to our Lake Superior fish. So some of these fish you might see kind of eking into our harbor here in front of their building, but not too many of these fish move very far up into the river. So you wouldn't see lake trout in the St. Louis River, but these really great sturgeon. So we have some sturgeon here, I think this is Helga here. It's hard to tell with the curve of the glass where I am. I'm gonna set this up so we can kind of take a closer look at this on the bottom. So sturgeon are the largest species of fish found in the Great Lakes. They can grow upwards of 8 feet long. Helga, oh, great way to ID them. What was the, I missed the ID tip.
Oh, the ID tip came from Mike Kutnick about muskies versus northerns. So muskies have dark spots on a light background, and northerns have light spots on a darker background.
Yep. So they're the largest species of fish found in the Great Lakes and in Lake Superior. They can grow upwards of 8 feet long, and they're a super long-lived species, which is important for kind of their story here along in Western Lake Superior and along the St. Louis River. So they can live, females can live upwards of close to 150 years and males over 100. And they've been able to determine this because fish and sturgeon have a bone, an otolith, an ear bone. And once that, unfortunately you can't tell until the fish has died, but they have been able to tell from either fish that have been caught or fish that have been found. For the longer lived species of sturgeon, it's a fairly reliable way to estimate age. It's a tiny little bone and you can saw it with a very fine saw and look underneath a microscope and count rings like a tree to determine the age of a sturgeon. So aside from having an animal live in human care or being born in a hatchery and living in human care and being able to count the candles on its birthday cake every year, it's really hard to know how old the sturgeon is. As I mentioned upstairs, the water temperature, well, we've got one that's cruising here, really good look at a sturgeon, yeah. So water temperature can have a big effect on its growth rate. Here in Lake Superior, we're basically in a big cold desert. There's not a lot of food out in the big lake. It's not as productive as some of the warmer, shallower lakes. And so the growth rate of a sturgeon in Lake Superior is gonna be much slower than a sturgeon perhaps in one of the warmer, shallower Great Lakes like Lake Michigan or further south, because there's just more food available. And so they live for a long time, and it takes them until they're about 20 years old before they reach maturity. Here we go, here's another good shot of the sturgeon, and before they breed. So they will live in Lake Superior and then travel back to the river where they were hatched to spawn. And here in Western Lake Superior, that is the St. Louis River. Now the problem comes around the 1970s when we couldn't find any evidence of lake sturgeon in Western Lake Superior anymore. So a lot of those habitat changes, some of the logging, there were some other industries along the river, their habitat changed, and overfishing. So pulling the fish out of the water had pretty well decimated the population. Fortunately, there was a big effort to reintroduce sturgeon into Lake Superior. And there were, I think, 13 or 14 stocking year classes up until 2000 that they were introducing fingerling sturgeon into the St. Louis River. And I remember very clearly, because I was already working at the aquarium at the time, but in the summer of 2011 was when they started finding young sturgeon in the St. Louis River again. And that was a huge deal because that told us that the sturgeon that had been introduced back into the river 20 years prior were starting to return and spawn. So we had our first kind of evidence that sturgeon were returning to this area. Now, 13 years of stocking class is not quite enough to be a return, to be a considered a recovered population. So there's still a lot of work going on with sturgeon restoration. And part of that is twofold. They were gonna start stocking this in summer 2020. And I guess I would again defer to anyone who might know if that happened. Obviously I spent a little less time on site in spring and summer when we were in lockdown, but I guess I don't know if they moved forward with sturgeon stocking. That was part of their plan in 2020, was to start stocking again.
I'm not sure, Alexis, honestly.
Yeah, okay, yeah, that's okay. That's a question I'm gonna have to find the answer to, because in late 2019 and early 2020, before we shut down, that was one of my hype stories about sturgeon, is we're gonna start stocking sturgeon again this year. So I'm gonna have to figure out what ended up happening.
Yeah, you're
So So I love the sturgeon story because it shows partnership across different agencies and nations. And it also shows that our community is committed to kind of restoring this really ancient, awesome species. And here comes another sturgeon. And I just think that they are the coolest fish. So if we talk about sturgeon, they have, they're flat bottomed fish. So you can kind of see them. Ooh, here we go. They're flat bottomed fish. Their mouths are subterminal or underneath their head. And their mouths are flat against the bottom of their head unless they find something that they want to eat. And then their mouth comes out like a sucker and they slurp it up. And so they kind of are trolling along the bottom. And like the catfish that we talked about upstairs, they do have external taste buds. So those whiskers or barbels, again, are sensory organs. And it's like those sturgeon have four tongues hanging out of their mouth all the time. Here's a nice look.
Say, Alexis, we got a question in the chat for you.
Oh, great.
Mike Kutnick is wondering, how many of your critters are rescues? Several of the fish look like they recovered from significant wounds.
That's a great, great observation. So I'm going to quick finish up about the sturgeon body shape, and then we'll talk about some of our old trout that have been making an appearance. Their barbels are sensory organs. Again, they're trolling along. It's like they have four tongues hanging out. And when they find something that they want to eat, young sturgeon eat aquatic insects. They will eat crayfish. They'll eat mollusks and crush up those shells. They don't have teeth, but they have a cartilage plate that helps to grind it up. And then they'll kind of pick up after other fish if there's something down on the bottom that is food. They, again, because Lake Superior is so big and so cold, there's no guarantee that they're going to find food for another little while. So they want to make sure that they can eat it when they can. So they are going to pick up what they can find on the bottom. And so then that mouth comes out like a vacuum and they slurp it right up. So to the question about how many of our animals are rescues. So we get animals in a few different ways. I'll just give you a nice calming shot of the big exhibit while we're talking here. So we get animals in a few different ways. So all of our birds are rehabilitated. So those are animals that have all been through rehabilitation and have been determined that they cannot be returned to the wild for various injuries. But then they were also determined that they would be good candidates for living in human care. A lot of our fish, so a lot of the trout that you see in this exhibit are from hatcheries. So we get our lake trout and brook trout. Actually, I think the brook trout in this exhibit most recently came from Shedd Aquarium. But the brown trout and the rainbow trout also came from hatcheries. The thing with these fish that are in here is some of these fish probably came to the big trout, especially the rainbow trout, probably came to the aquarium shortly after I started, maybe a couple of years after I started. So we're seeing a lot of really big kind of old trout in this exhibit. So some of them may have sustained injuries before they get to the aquarium, and some of them are just kind of old. So we start to see their fins fraying a little bit. We see the fatty humps on their back and things like that. It depends on the species, some of the animals. All right, we're gonna have bonus. This is not related to the St. Louis River, but this is related to that question of where animals come from. So we're gonna go a little marine, but we're still mostly freshwater. We're gonna visit some animals born here at the aquarium. So some of the animals are actually born here at the aquarium. So the potbelly seahorses and the bay pipefish that you see here are actually born here at the aquarium. So some of the animals are born here. Some of the animals we get from hatcheries. Some of the animals we get from trades with other facilities. We had one of our senior aquarists is, as you can see, she does an amazing job at providing a habitat for reproduction for these animals. So we have a really good amount of pipefish and seahorses. And we just sent 50 little tiny clownfish born here at the aquarium to the Minnesota Zoo. So we do a lot of trades with other aquariums. And one that's really important to us is we want to make sure that any animals that are coming into our facility are coming in a way that is sustainable and appropriate for that animal. So baby clownfish are just as cute as you might imagine, but they got dropped off yesterday down at the Minnesota Zoo. And then the other way that we get them is I think through rehab, as we talked about with the birds, the otters, were non-releasable wildlife. So yeah, those are the main ways we get them. Crush, the snapping turtle, got shipped to us from Pennsylvania via either FedEx or UPS in a giant box. So.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. All right, so I think that puts us pretty close. I like that folks have been asking questions all along, but we definitely have time for a few more questions if anybody has them. I tried to see if the otters would be awake for us, but it looks like their habitat is empty. They're snoozing.
Oh, bummer.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, folks, but please feel free to come off mute or throw a question in the chat if you have it.
While we're down here, you know, since we're walking around, we'll visit Freeway. I hear him chatting. Freeway is another non-releasable wildlife. He's an American crow. So we'll say hi to him.
That sounds great.
Whoa, Freeway. That's one of his familial calls. He knows I'm over here, so he was trying to get me to come over and say hi.
That's so great.
Hi, Freeway. Whoa. Either that or he knew that I was talking to Dick Anderson. He wanted to come say hi. Yeah, so we've made a lot of changes here at the aquarium so that we can safely reopen. And we have to run back upstairs because I was going to talk about some of the ways that we have been working to be inclusive, and I totally skipped all those pieces I was going to talk about. But we do have one of the things that our previous inclusion coordinator really worked with us on in 2019 and leading up to right before we had to close in March of 2020 is we were able to put together a tactile tour. So all of the things that we just talked about and explored, we have different sorts of tours set up so that folks can join us and they can explore the aquarium in a non-visual way. And what that means is we have our interpretive staff trained to use really descriptive language. We have some braille books and now I've just run up the stairs. We have braille books and some audio description that you can check out from the aquarium so you can experience it. And then some of the coolest stuff we have are different props. This is a mounted wood duck that we got from Warner Nature Center as they were getting ready to close. And that allows our visitors that either have low vision or no vision to be able to really understand what a wood duck's body is like without using their sense of sight. And we have similar props like trout, so we can describe it head to tail. And here's one of our wood turtles as a prop as well. So
awesome.
we're still doing tactile tours, and you can call ahead of time. We like to have a few days notice so that we can make sure to schedule someone, but that's one of the ways that, yeah, I know we're so sad about Warner. But that's one of the ways that we can make sure that folks have the ability to really experience the aquarium in a rich and meaningful way, even if they don't have sight.
That's really awesome, Alexis. Yeah, you guys have done a really great job of opening up access to a lot of different folks. Really cool.
And we know it's really challenging just in general right now to kind of get some of those accommodations, just given how complicated the world is. But we always encourage folks, if you have those sorts of needs or are interested in accommodations to really just reach out. You'll probably end up getting in touch with me and we can work out a way for you to visit to be able to experience the aquarium in a really awesome way.
That's really great, Alexis.
Yeah, I'm so glad that folks were able to join us. We definitely miss seeing people here at the aquarium, and one of the benefits to this sort of situation is that folks who might not otherwise have the opportunity to visit the aquarium and other places get access to aquarium exhibits and the awesome talks. And it sounds like there's going to be something awesome happening next time, Ryan, that we're going to want to come back for.
Yes.
If you liked learning about the St. Louis River, you're going to love
the River of Poems. March 3rd, same time, 7 p.m. We're going to be hosting poets from around the country reading their river-themed poetry. So it should prove to be a really, really great river talk. Come on back. Keep an eye on our Facebook page, facebook.com/Lake Superior Reserve, to get all the details, or check out our website, lakesuperiorreserve.org. It's going to be a good one.
And we were talking before the program that you should be encouraged to see if you can make your own sturgeon themed poetry in preparation.
Yeah, we prefer haiku, but we won't limit it to just that.
Yeah, if you want to make a sturgeon rap, set it to music. Sturgeon are awesome. So, and one of the things that I love so much about this region and about Lake Superior and the St. Louis River is that it has always been an important part of storytelling for people who live around the area. So when we think of river poems and we think about the history of people living in this region, you know, there are so many stories explaining Lake Superior, you know, in different ways, both from Native American stories to modern day songs to the Edmund Fitzgerald.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So
a lot of great stories come out of this place for sure.
Yeah. Well, thanks for letting me share a little bit of our story with you all today.
Absolutely. Thanks much for coming, Alexis. It was really, really awesome. The chat is very, very, very positive.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, y'all. We'll see you next time.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye now.